said you were a prophet. Some even dismiss you as a liar. You were a cornerstone.
Well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Welcome to Women from the Fire Ministry up here in Billings, Montana. I'm your MC, Apostle Dr. Sulyans-Gibson. We're just waiting on our speaker for the night. Now, here's the million-dollar question again. Can you hear me? Because if not, I got to solve this now. Can you hear me? Can someone respond? Can you hear me? Let me see, do the chat.
Okay. I can hear you, Apostle.
Well, praise the Lord. So we're good on that. I'm just waiting for our speaker to come on.
Anyway,
our topic tonight is forgiveness. Matthew 18, 26 through 30 says, so the slave fell on his knees and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will repay you for everything. And his master's heart was moved with compassion, and he released him and forgave him, canceling the debt. But that same slave went out and found one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denars. And he seized him and began choking him, saying, pay what you owe. So his fellow slave fell on his knees and begged him earnestly, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he was unwilling, and he went and had him thrown in prison until he paid back the debt. Hello, somebody. We know some people like that. Well, I'm going to turn it over to our speaker tonight. We have from Perfected Praise Ministries himself, we have Elder Raymond Rudloph. I want everybody to put themselves on mute so I can catch him speaking, and then we will take it from there. You know, I'm really not feeling this sign in over here. Everything's so new over here. I had to read this and read that. Let me see if this will work like it's supposed to here. Talking about sign in. I'm already in. How am I going to sign in again? Bear with me. Let's see here. Speaker. Okay, good. It's record. Okay. Everybody mute and...
Oh, Lord. Okay. Praise God. Praise God. Can everybody hear me? Praise God. Yes, we thank and we magnify God for this time. I just honor him for this time to be here, to be able to do anything for him is really a blessing. And so I honor him and I glorify him. And I'm just going to go in a word of prayer before we go into our Bible study.
Okay.
Father, in the name of Jesus, God, as we come to you today, oh God, we thank you for this time, oh God, that we can gather together as your people, oh God, to learn from you, to have more knowledge of you, oh God. God, we just thank you for the day, for how you brought us through the day, for how you kept us, for how you kept our minds stayed on you, and you brought us to this time right here, oh God. Father, as I begin to speak, I ask that you would go before me, oh God, prepare the way, prepare the hearts, oh God, that what is about to be given out, that will be received, oh God, and that you would do what you need to do, oh God, and that the hearers would be receptive of your word. I ask this all in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless everybody. As you can see, the scripture is forgiveness. And I'm sure we know what forgiveness is, but I will go into a little bit of it. Woo! All of us, we all need forgiveness. We all need forgiveness. And it says, what is forgiveness? Forgiveness is the action or the process of forgiving or being forgiven. It's also known as a pardon, absolution, exoneration, or remission. It is defined as conscious and deliberate decision to release the feeling of resentment or vengeance toward a person or a group that has harmed you. Meaning if somebody has harmed you, you're willing to go ahead. I'm willing to forgive you. Regardless of whether they actually deserve your forgiveness or not, they should have it. They need to have it. I will start here with this one. because there are three types of forgiveness. I'm going to break them down to you. The first one is called detached forgiveness. Detached, I mean, not detached. It's called, there is a reduction and a negative feeling toward the offender, but no reconciliation takes place. That is detached forgiveness. That's the first one. The second one is called limited forgiveness. There is a reduction in the negative feeling toward the offender, and their relationship is partially restored, not all the way there, but it's partially restored. There is a decrease in their emotional intensity and the cessation of negative feeling toward the offender, and the relationship is partially restored. Number three is full forgiveness. There is a total cessation of negative feeling. In other words, you're not feeling anything negative anymore. You have forgiven of negative feelings toward the offender, and the relationship is fully restored, meaning you have come back to, we're in right standing now. Whatever you did has been forgiven. We're back in right standing. You know, as the Lord has led me to a book, and it's called Total Forgiveness. And as I was reading the book, the Lord began to point out some various things about myself. You know, I had tried to read it before, and I got part the way. You know, sometimes, how can you say, sometimes the Lord brings up things in your life and you're not really ready to receive it. You're not really ready to deal with it. But there's a time you have to face things. And this dealing with forgiveness and unforgiveness, and this was my time, because I have put things on hold for so long. So as I begin to read the book, the Holy Spirit began to deal with me over the past couple of weeks. I was talking with Apostle, even going to work. And, you know, the Holy Spirit just began to deal with me with some things that were going on in my family, you know, things that had taken place from a little child. I'm kind of getting ahead of myself, but as the Lord has reminded me, things that had taken place as a child, there, you know, I hadn't let it go. You know, we always say, oh, you know, I forgive. Yeah. But how much do we really forgive? How much do we forgive? When you look at it, when you forgive, you stop feeling angry or you stop feeling resentful toward a person that has done something to you, that's harmed you. You stop feeling angry. When you come to forgiveness is the action, is actually the process of going through, the process of forgiving. Like I said, an example I'll give you. If you say, he is quick to ask for forgiveness when he stepped over the line. If somebody does something to you, all of a sudden, when they recognize it, oh, forgive me. He's quick to ask for forgiveness. Then you come to forgiving. Forgiven is what you receive. You are granted a pardon for the mistake or wrongdoing. If we look at it, Jesus is the perfect example. When you talk about forgiven, the perfect example. As we look, you know, oh my gosh. Like I said, this really hits home to me because there's a lot of people in my life I didn't know how to forgive. And that growing up, I didn't want to forgive. But how can I ask for forgiveness? How can I ask for forgiveness and I don't forgive them? They're asking me to forgive, or, you know, time has gone on, but yet in my heart is stony. My heart is just far away. If I'm going to ask for forgiveness from God, would I not forgive the person? that's around me? Would I not forgive my neighbor? Would I not forgive my children? I need to have an open heart to forgive. And I'll be honest with you, I didn't want to. But you know what that does when you choose not to forgive? It cuts you off. It cuts you off from the things that would be coming your way. Man, I focus on forgiveness because, like I said, it was an area that the Lord was dealing with me. When you think about forgiveness, what is forgiveness? Why do I need forgiveness? That's just a couple of questions. What does it mean to truly forgive? Is there a benefit? Think about it. Is there a benefit in forgiving? Is there a benefit in forgiving yourself and others, people that have harmed you? I had to think about this. I had to most definitely think about this because it was something that it lived with me. It plagued me. I could not get away from it. And I thank God that at this point in time, He's dealt with me about it and still dealing with me about it. Yes, I've shed tears because people have hurt me, but I also have to remember that I've hurt others. I have to put myself in the point, okay, how does God see it? How does God see it? I don't want to forgive, but okay, if I don't have no right to ask for forgiveness. I don't have any right to ask, oh Lord, please forgive me. He said, you can't even forgive your brother. You see them every day. You won't forgive them. Let me go on to the next that I have down hand. If we look at Ephesians 4 and 32, it states, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other as Christ God has forgave you. It's something He's telling us to do. I mean, it's, you need it. You need to forgive. If we go to Colossians 3:13, it states, bear with each other. And I believe this is coming from the Amplified version, so it might read a little different. It says, bear with each other, forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another, as the Lord has forgave you. I wrote down, I'm going to tell you what total forgiveness is not. And I wrote down some, I think it's probably about 10 of them that I'm going to give to you. And it says, total forgiveness is not giving approval for what somebody did to you. That means if somebody hurt you, that's not giving them the approval. That's not what total forgiveness is not. It does not excuse what the person did to you. If I can be blunt, you know, if you suffered any trauma, if you suffered rape, molestation, it does, you know, that person was wrong for what they did. But like I said, it does not excuse for what they did. So that's what total forgiveness is not. It's not justifying what they did. They were wrong in their actions. So it's not justifying them. It's not pardoning what they did. It's not giving them that right. Oh yeah, you had right. Number five, reconciliation. It's not saying that you're going to reconcile with them. Number six, it's not denying what they did. If you've been hurt by a family member, a loved one, it's not denying what they did. Number seven, you're not blind to what happened. That's what not for total forgiveness is not. Number eight is forgetting. Number nine is refusing to take the wrong seriously. And number 10 is pretending that we are not hurt. Now we're going on to what total forgiveness is. Number one, being aware of what someone has done and still you forgive them. That's what total forgiveness is. Number two, choosing to keep no record of the wrong. I had an incident where I was molested as a child. And when you think, even if you watch movies and you see certain things happen, it comes back in your mind. And the mind is something else, because you replay that tape over and over and over. And you carry feelings of bitterness and harshness, you know, and they can go with you for years, because I had my experience follow me for over 30 years. But in my heart, I refuse to forgive. Oh, this happened to me. So I ain't gonna forgive. Number three is refusing to punish. Even if I know the person that did something to me, I refuse to punish them. Number four, it's not going around telling what they did. In other words, well, you know, this person did that to me, not spreading it. Number five is being merciful. Being merciful to that person or those people that hurt you. Number six is being gracious. Not being phony. I mean, yeah, you may have some issues going on, but that's why you give it to God and have him help you. You be gracious. Number seven, it is an inner condition that takes place in the heart. That's what total forgiveness is. It takes place on the inside. You can speak it out here, but what has happened on the inside? Have you totally forgiven? Number eight, it is the absence of bitterness. Number nine, this was a different one. I guess somebody goes, It's saying forgiving God. I know some people said, wait, did you just say forgiving God? I'll come back to that and I'll explain that one. And also forgiving ourselves. When I was researching, I thought about forgiving God. I'm like, wait a minute, God is God. But I had an incident, and I'm trying not to rush, but I'm trying to get out what's in my heart. I had an incident some years back. My mother passed away. And matter of fact, my mother, my brother, my sister, my father, everybody had passed away. And we were at the gravesite of my mother. We had just laid her to rest. You know, we had a service and everything. So we were coming to the point where we were getting ready to go to the repast. And I remember I turned around and I looked at my mother's coffin. And when I looked at her, it began to hit me that this is my last family member. I mean, immediate. This is mom. And I remember I turned around and I didn't shake my fist up to heaven, but I remember I threw my hands up like that. And you know what? Inside of me, I said to God, are you happy? You have them all now. And I was hot. I'm not going to lie. I was hot. And tears streaming down my face. February is cold. I'm surprised the tears didn't freeze on my face while I was crying, especially in New York. But I was sitting there, I was like, are you happy? And, you know, and I'm like, you have them all. And I was stretching my hand out because, you know, my sisters are buried here. My brother's buried here. And I was like, are you happy? You have them all. And I remember I got into the limousine and we pulled off. And I buried that thing inside of me for years. I never really came to terms with it until the Lord began to deal with me about forgiveness. I've walked with that for years. And I had to realize that I had to forgive God. I had to forgive God. I had to take him, you know, it wasn't his fault. God is an almighty God. Things happen that we have no control over. We didn't ask for them to happen. They just happened. I also thought about, when we think about forgiving God, you think of a person that has had a child, and for whatever reason, the child is taken away from them. You think about the person that's suffered a miscarriage, or a mom that's had, you know, the child in her stomach, and for whatever reason, that child comes and that child is stillborn. Man, do you have it in you to forgive God for something like that? How do you feel? How do you deal with something like that? I used to question all my life, why would God let this happen? Why would God let that happen? You know, we ask God all these things, and then we wind up blaming God. Well, see, you God, so, you know, you could have saved my mama. You could have saved my daddy. You could have saved my brother. You know what came to me today as I was doing some more studying? It was like, you wanted me to save them, but what sort of condition was your mother in before she left? Do you know the pain that your mother was in? Do you know the pain that your father was in? Do you know what they were suffering? Do you know what cancer was doing to their body? Do you understand? But you wanted them to be here. I had to forgive God. Because yes, I wanted my family member to be here. But at what cost? Just because I wanted them here? But God knows better. He knows that they would have been suffering. Because see, he can see way down the road. He can see what was coming up where I couldn't see because I'm limited at what I can see. I can see only this in front of my face. Or maybe a little ways off, especially if I got my glasses on. But God can see way down the line to where, okay, they may be all right for a month. They may be all right for 3 months. But you don't know what's coming. So me taking them home is grace and mercy. That's love, that I don't let them lay there on tubes for years and months. Like I said, I had to forgive God. Can a mother forgive God when she lost a child, when she loses a child? Can a father forgive God? I'm just going to give you some for instance. If his daughter is raped, can he forgive God? Will he be able to forgive the offender that has done this to his child? I am a father of quite a few girls, and I had to think about it. Could I forgive someone that has done something to my child? Can I truly say, as a member of the body of Christ, can I forgive him? If God don't help me, no. If I had to be with him myself, oh, no. I ain't forgiving them. I want to get even. That's what I want. I want to get even. But that's not what God wants for us. If we look at ourselves, look at the stuff that we've done. Look at the stuff that we've done. Why? Why should we be forgiven? We've said things. We've done things. Why should we be forgiven? I tell you, I don't know how many of you have made the statement. I know I've made the statement before. It says, I'll forgive, but I won't forget. I'll forgive, but I won't forget. I remember sitting in the church. We're going to get raw, real, and relevant. I remember sitting in the church. I'll forget, but I won't forget. Head turning all over the place. Arms folded. Yep. Oh, I was a piece of work. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Then you have to ask yourself, did you truly forgive? Because at one point you said, I'll forgive, but I won't forget. Okay. What would that be like an oxymoron? I'll forgive, but I won't forget. As the people of God, what sort of state does that put us in? How do we look? Because a lot of times we say, we make these very statements. And we may, even if we may not say it out loud, sometimes we might be thinking it. Because you know what? Your thoughts will get you in trouble. Oh, buddy, they'll get you in trouble. We are found in a state of unforgiving. Just like that servant in Matthew 18 and 26 through 30. When he asked for forgiveness, remember? When he asked for forgiveness from the master, then he forgave him. Mm-hmm. But then he found somebody that owed him, and he went outside and went to go choke him up. You owe me. You gonna pay me. But wait a minute. Your master just forgave you. What sort of state are we walking around in? Let me continue on. Also in forgiveness, because it is something the Lord requires of us, that we find ourselves, we don't find ourselves in a bad place with God. When you don't forgive, you can find yourself in a bad place with God. Because in the scriptures, asking you to forgive, the Lord is telling you to forgive, but you're like, okay, I heard it, but I ain't moving on it. Let's look at 2 Corinthians 2 and 9 through 11. It says this, For this was my purpose in writing, to see if you would stand the test, or whether you would be obedient and committed to following the instructions in all things. Verse 10, if you forgive anyone anything, I too forgive. And what I have forgiven, if I have forgiven anything, it has been for your sake and in the presence and the approval of Christ. The last thing we want to do, want in the world, is for God to be our enemy. We don't want God to be our enemy. I was thinking, I said, you know what? We don't want God to tell the stuff that we did, because you know what? Even though we are dressed up in robes and you know, we're looking all holy on Sunday, I mean, we don't want God to tell our business. I was chuckling to myself that I said, because you know what? God got receipts. He got receipts. He knows what it is that we've done. So when we come and he says, forgive, you know, forgive. He said, nope, I can't, because they did this. They looked at me wrong. Nope, can't forgive. He said, no, you need to forgive them. You need to love them. Nope, can't do it. Mm-mm. They looked at me cross-eyed. Mm. Nope. What sort of state does that put us in? Not a good state. That's why this dealing with forgiveness, it went real deep. It cut real deep because it allowed me to see myself. And that's what forgiveness is for. It allows us to see ourselves and allow us to go through the process. Not that we're going to get it perfect every day. No, we're not going to get it perfect every day. We're going to fail. We're going to stumble. But it's in that process that we become more like God. It's in that process. Sometimes it's just so difficult. It's just difficult. At one time, like I said, it was difficult for me to forgive. I had a father that did not live in the home with me. He had other children. When I found this out, it made me very angry. They were living one life and I was living another life. Okay, my mother, we were modest. We lived in the projects. But my father's other children, they lived in a house. They had cars. They dressed a certain way. And here I am, we living in the projects, eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. or chicken back, or, you know, fat back, or whatever. How do you, as a kid, how does that make you feel? Like, why? If that's my father, how come I can't be with him? But see, there was a whole bunch of stuff that went on in the situation. See, there was a lot I had to forgive. I had to be real within myself because, you know, my father already had a family. He may have sent money to my mother for me, but that didn't take away how I felt about him. I had to forgive him because I was mad. I was very mad because a young Black child growing up in New York without a father. Ugh. Who am I going to go fishing with? Who's going to take me to a baseball game, a basketball game? Who? See, there were things that were swirling around in my mind that the enemy wanted me to carry. Unforgiveness for the rest of my life. And you know what unforgiveness does to you? It makes your heart hard. Excuse me. It hardens your heart. It does. It hardens your heart. A lot of times I laid in bed, you know, dealing with stuff as the Lord was giving me this. Migraines, bad migraines. Sick to my stomach. Anxious, anxiety through the roof. That was me. But until I learned to forgive, even my wife at the time, she told me, she said, you know what, you need to forgive your father. At one point, I didn't want to. But I had to make amends with a situation that now I'm older, I'm grown. So, you know, I still want to hold on to a little bit, but you know what? Let me tell you what God did. He worked out a situation so much so that my father was, at this time, he was in the hospital. He was very sick. He was dealing with cancer. And I went to the hospital, and I'm going to be honest. You know, at one point, you know, I don't know if I see him. At that time in my mind, I'm like, well, he just deal with whatever he deals with, okay? I'm just going to, this is my father, and I'm just going to go and do a charitable thing. But while I was there, you know what? I watched God do something with my father. I watched my father recognize me as his child years later. Do you know what that did to me? That melted my stony heart because all I wanted was that recognition. And I could not, my God, I could not no longer hold hatred toward this man. I couldn't. And my story would be longer, but I'm, you know, for the sake of time, I could not hold hatred toward him. So I began to forgive him as we began to talk. And little did I know what was about to take place. You know, I'm saying I brought him, my father wasn't a man to receive flowers. I brought him a rose. He was grateful. I brought him a card, some nice words in there, read the card to him. Father was a very proud man. He wasn't going to show too much emotion. I read the card to him, even sat there and helped him to eat dinner he didn't want to eat. But in a small way, he was showing me that he loved me because he was saying, here, you take my plate. I don't want to eat anything. And I was like, what is this man doing? He's sick and needs to eat. But in some small way, he was showing me love. And you know what? I had to realize, I forgave him. So I took that. And I said, well, if you drink this, you can get big and strong and you can get out of the hospital. And so I ate the food. So we talked and we laughed and everything. To make a long story short, after that, I prayed with my father. You know, and I prayed that, you know, that he would receive the Lord. And he prayed right along with me. And that was good. And I said, okay, Dad, because I didn't really call him Dan. I called him by his name, which was Harold. And I was like, okay, Harold. But before it came out of my mouth, I said, all right, Dad, I'm about to go. And he looked at me and I said, I love you. And he said, I love you. Let me tell you, before I could get home on the train, going back home to my house, My father passed away. My father, gone. By the time I couldn't even, by the time I got in the door, my mother had pulled me to the side. She said, Raymond, he's gone. And I'm like, what you talking about? She's like, he's gone. I'm like, she said, your father. I'm like, wait a minute, I just saw him. And then I thought to myself, I said, man, God, I thank you. I thank you for the chance to forgive him. Because see, I don't know what that did for him. Me allowing him off the hook. He know what it, he knows what it is that he's done. He knows it. But like I was just reading, you don't keep no record of what it is that people have done to you if you truly forgive. And at that moment in time, God did something for me that I was able to forgive him and to know that I prayed with him, I had a meal with him, and after that, he went on home. Yeah, I was sad that he was gone, but to live now, to know, hey, God, you know what? You made a moment with me and my father. Total forgiveness. I don't harbor hate towards him any longer. I don't harbor hate towards my other siblings. Before I did. I'm not going to lie. I did. I did not want to forgive like the Bible says. It would be just like, you remember the story of Joseph and his brothers? Remember what they did to Joseph? And when he finally got to the palace and they went and they needed something and they were there and they stood before Joseph. He could have put them on blast. He really, y'all threw me in a pit. This is what y'all did to me. You lied to my father. Told my father I was dead. Da, 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 da. But because of the love of God, he couldn't help the day, you know, what God blessed him with, the gift that God blessed him with, that he was able to dream and interpret dreams. That he couldn't help it. That was the gift and calling of without repentance. Am I right? Yeah. But instead of going bad on him, going after him, he loved them. He loved them. He didn't say, oh, you know, these are my brothers and they threw me in a pit and, you know, they left me for dead. They lied. He loved them. He loved them so much so he refused to bring up the mess that they did. I'm sure we've had people in our life that have done that. But God is teaching us. We have to let stuff go. This is why we're suffering heart attacks, strokes, aneurysms. Stuff shows out in the body. And he's asking us, will you forgive? Do you have forgiveness? That was one of the things I put down. Do you have forgiveness? Are you willing to forgive? You may have to go back 20, 30 years. You know, the Lord may bring things to your remembrance. Just like with me, he brought things to my remembrance. And I literally had to sit there and cry because I'm like, I'm like, okay, but if I love God and I said, I want to do the will of God, I want to be what God has called me to be. I want to show love to one another. I said, I'm looking to win souls. I want to win souls over here and over there, but I'm not willing to forgive somebody, whether they're in my household, whether they're in the church, I'm not willing to forgive. No, I want to be able to love just like Christ loved. The love that he had for me when he hung on the cross, when he was beat all night. Come on. I want to have that type of forgiveness. And you know, he went through, y'all know he was beat, mocked, scourged, all of that, shed his blood for us. But yet, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When people were speaking against him, forgive them. What are you talking about? Forgiveness. Forgive your brother. Forgive your sister. Forgive. That's a very hard word nowadays. I've kind of went off my nose, away from my nose, but forgiveness. We need to go through the process. We need to put on our big boy pants, a nice little lady dress. We need to be honest. And you know what I found out? That I was able to say to God, you know what? This hurt me. That hurt me. I don't see how I can ever get past. But you know what? I believe in Micah, and I'll get that scripture. He says, you know, give it to me. Give it to me. That stuff that you can't handle, that burden that you can't handle, that case of unforgiveness that you can't handle, give it to God. Because he can handle it. We can. We cannot handle it. Just like, let me find the scripture. And I believe it's in, Micah. Just give me 1 second. Yep. Like it says, let's see. It said, and you know, there's a scripture in the Bible that says, when the Lord has forgiven you, he don't remember your sins no more. Micah 7 and 19, an Amplified version, it says it like this. He will turn again and he will have compassion upon us. And he will subdue our iniquities. And thou will cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. Cast them. He cast them away. If we look at Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 16 and 17, it says, and this is the covenant that I will make with them, that after those days, saith the Lord, I will imprint my laws upon their heart and on their mind, and I will inscribe them, producing an inward change. My God. Then he says, their sins and their lawless acts and their sins and iniquities, I will remember no more. Now that's what you call forgiveness. The Lord used to have, he struck me with something I used to do before. I used to get on myself, and I'm going to go to another section here, but you know, he said, okay, Lord, forgive me. Okay, I'm not going to do that no more. Okay, you give it to him. And he throws it into the sea of forgetfulness. You know what the Lord said to me one day? He said, why do you continue to go fishing in the sea? I've forgiven you. Why do you get the fishing rod to go in there and pull out that very thing? Why do you keep fishing? It's gone. But yet, what you looking for? That's to see it, unforgiveness. Why are you digging in something that I've forgiven you? Because he's not a liar. If he says, I've forgiven you for murdering, I've forgiven you for slander, I've forgiven you for backbiting, I've forgiven you for adultery, I've forgiven you for that you've done, because you've come clean to me. Why go looking for it? I fell out laughing. He said, why you keep going? Why you keep looking over there? Why you keep going after it when I've forgiven it? I'm not a man that I should lie. You know what? There's a, what it says, sin that is confessed to God now is totally forgiven by him. You hear that? If you have confessed your sins to God, it is totally forgiven by him. You ain't got to wonder. No. That If he said, I forgive you, I forgive you. Yeah. And any guilt that we feel after that, it's called pseudo guilt. And pseudo, that word is, you know, it's false. In other words, it's a false guilt. It's something we take on ourselves. Yeah. Sometimes you have a guilty guilt, but you know that you're guilty. I don't know why I put it like that, but it's a guilty guilt. You really, there's no harm about it. You know that you're guilty. You know what you've done and you ask for forgiveness for. Then you have pseudo guilt. And the reason I put it like that is that, which I believe the enemy likes to plague us. You know how you ask for forgiveness or something, and you know, have you ever had the enemy come to you? Mm. You think God forgave you? Yeah, nah, God ain't forgive you. Why would he forgive you? Look, that's a big sin you did. That's just me. I'm, like I said, I'm being raw and relevant. That's me. That's the way the enemy used to plague my mind. We'll say, oh, you know, God didn't forgive you, but he did. And the Lord would keep saying, why do you keep coming back? I've already forgiven you. And he said, if you're forgiven, you are forgiven. After we have confessed it, the Lord has it. Let's not take it back. Like I said, pseudo guilt is not real. It's not real. Even though it seems and it feels as though it's real, it's not. You know, there is an excellent reason why God tells us to have his spirit. Because his spirit will lead us into all truth. It won't lead us wrong. That's why we need to be washed, blood bought, baptized in his Holy Ghost, reading the word so that his word, the spirit of truth, will come into us and we will begin to live and move forward. Will it happen like that? Some cases, some people, it does. Other people, you have to work at it. What is that song? It said, we fall down, but we get up. True that. We fall down, but we can get back up. That's why it's important to have the Spirit of God. It's important. I heard my brother say today, you know, that these are some rough times. Rough times. And families are going through. Forgiveness is one of the big things that has families divided. I don't like you because you did this. I don't like you because I think mama liked you better. I don't like this because grandma gave you a shoe, a pearl necklace, and I ain't got one. Unforgiveness, hating one another. And unfortunately, you know what? What's so sad about it? It finds its way into the church. Oh, you spoke this Sunday. And I thought I speak better than you. So you're sitting there in the congregation, mad, pissed off. I know because I've been there, done that. But yet all the while, God is looking for me to get it together and to say to him, you know what? I'm hurt because I wanted this. I wanted that. There's a reason in that. Let me take that back. There's a time and a place for all things. Where's the scripture? It says, come boldly to the throne of grace. We can come boldly and bring what it is we have. I'm telling you, this talk on forgiveness is doing me wonders because not only can I forgive others, but I can forgive Raymond. That's a big one. I can forgive Raymond for the things that I did in my marriage that were wrong, that caused a division in my marriage, that caused my children to be hurt. I can do that. And then while I'm doing that, God will send someone along like he did with Apostle Gibson to help me out to be able to go back and to apologize, to see where I was wrong and ask for forgiveness from my children. Like I said, not excusing what I was, knowing what I did was wrong. Yeah, they were mad. They were hurt. Yeah. But because I took instructions that was given from God to go and to make things right. Even if they said, no, I don't want to forgive you, whatever, whatever. The thing is that you hear instructions. And then when you hear clear instructions, you go and you follow the instructions. Then after that, it's off of you. But praise God, I thank God that I've done that because I now have a relationship with my children. I have a better relationship with family members. Do I have it with all family members? Nope. But we're working on it. But I choose to forgive. I choose to forgive. Is it easy? It still ain't easy, but I all right, Lord, here you go. This is a big one for me. You know, this is a big one for me. You know, I was thinking about some things that the Lord told me about myself. And you know what? When you forgive somebody, let me tell you one thing that happens. It frees you to what's been holding you captive. When you forgive, it frees you. It allows you. That weight comes off. Woo. If you've ever had a backpack on, like when you went to school and it was weighing you down, when you truly forgive, it frees you. That weight comes off your shoulder. The second thing, you're able to sleep and rest better when you forgive. Try to go to sleep with a whole bunch of stuff on your mind. You're flip, flop, toss and turn in the bed. It's not easy. But when you forgive, you can get that good night's sleep. You're not at work sitting there going like, ugh. You're not at work dreading that dreading to go home. I don't want to go home. Oh, I don't love my husband. I don't love my wife. I got to deal with this. Got to deal with that. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. Who should you forgive? Everybody. Everyone. It doesn't matter. Everyone. Those who have done us wrong, forgive them. Like I said, we forgive ourselves. And we got to forgive God. We got to take God off the hook. Yeah. Things happen. We couldn't have it. May have had an abortion or whatever situation. We have to forgive God. Some people have done some damnable things. Yeah. It's, I only did it because this happened or that happened. But we forgive God. We forgive others and we forgive ourselves. I'm going to, let me see. I've got something the Lord placed on my heart because he deals with me in illustration. All those things that were sown. I don't know, could you hear me? Okay. While those things that were sown, tares grew right along with it while they were sleeping, pretty much. But the Lord gave me an illustration that I want to give you. You see this tree right here? And I'm going to break it down. There inside, here are some seeds. Okay, well, you probably can't see them, but yeah, there are some seeds. Right? You have some seeds. And we are going to look at those seeds as thoughts. Those are thoughts, okay? Hold on to that. Now, we're going to look, this right here is our dirt. You know, the dirt that you plant, you plant seeds in, okay? The soil is going to be the mind or the heart. Stay with me. Right. Now, if you look underneath, what are these? These are roots. Okay. So when you look at it, you plant the seed in the soil, right? And it takes a while for it to germinate. It takes a minute, but after a while, it goes down after it's been in the soil and it's been watered and everything else like that. It begins to get roots, right? The roots grow down, and there's something I'm going to read to you what roots, what they do. But after that, you have to, once the roots grow down, then it becomes a plant, and a plant becomes a tree, okay? And then the tree, after a while, as you can see, we'll call those the fruit that are on the tree. Ah, but what kind of fruit is it? Let me go back to this. The root, like I showed you, the roots, they are to feed and they help bring forth the fruit. The function of the root, it absorbs water and minerals. That's what roots do. As they go down, roots also, they provide the proper anchorage for the plant, keeps the plants stable. As the roots go down, it grabs a hold of. And so that way, the, you know, it's not going all over. Not only that, the roots, they store food materials. And then the synthesis of the plant grows regulated. So everything is done in the roots. My thing is, what do you allow to go into your soil? Remember, I said the soil is your mind and it's your heart. What are you allowing to be planted in your heart? Unforgiveness, bitterness, malice, envy. What are you allowed to be planted in your mind and in your heart? What is it? As a man thinketh, so is he. Okay. If we look at the seeds, thoughts, words, what are you allowing to enter your mind? What are you allowed to be spoken to you? Because whether you know it or not, they grab a hold and they do take root. And like I said, roots, they grab a hold. The Lord had given me an illustration. He wants us to get rid of the bitterness. There's things that we have walked around and we have carried. Things that we have not let go of. And we cannot progress any further until we allow the Lord to deal with these things in our life. Like I said, we can put on clothes and robes and collars and everything else like that. But you know what? You wind up being a dressed up mess. I'm just going to be honest with you. Hold on to this thought. What is planted in the ground feeds the tree. Yeah. What you plant is going to feed the tree. If you're going to put in mess, you're going to get mess. Mm-hmm. Do you know that there is bitterness has a smell to it? Did you know that? Mm-hmm. It's a sharp smell too. Just like when you know that something is rotten, you know, most definitely rotten has a smell to it. You don't, you know, you kind of frowned up your face. I don't like that. But peace, joy, happiness, it also has a smell. Have you ever walked past a field and you know, you smell jasmine or, you know, you're like, ooh, man, that smells like heaven. Yeah. Yeah. Our actions have a smell to it. So guess what? Unforgiveness has a smell. Mm-hmm. We can work around all day long and say, oh, yeah, I forget. Mm-hmm. It has a smell. That's why the ministers of God, they encourage the saints. That's what we're supposed to be. We're lovers one to another. We encourage saints. You know what? Oh, I see this in you. It's not to be in your business, but maybe you should pray about this. Maybe you should ask the Lord to help you with this. Some people have been there, done that. You know, don't look at it as them being a busybody, but they're watching out for your soul. Pretty much, that's what I'm saying. He wants us to forgive. I have them right here with me.
So, RJ, let us open up the line because you gave a whole lot. So let us open up, mute everybody, unmute comments because I got quite a few. You took me back down memory lane. Thank you so much. Amen. So let us unmute. And I want to thank you on this because it was a lot. This is one thing topic that you need to work on constantly because forgiveness is a daily process. Because you can get somebody to call you with a slick willy comment, and you got to catch yourself so you don't catch an attitude. Or you can be in the middle of doing something, and the enemy will speak something to your spirit to try to have you abort what you already heard the Holy Spirit to tell you to do. I'm not going to go with all these things you broke down, but I want to holler about what you said. I love the best. What he said, God, God got receipts. Come on, somebody, have mercy. God got some receipts. And why do you keep on fishing in the sea of forgiveness? I know that's right. But I wanted to encourage everybody because what this is really about is that if you don't have a relationship with the Lord, you're not going to be able to do forgiveness correctly. You got to stay in the presence of the Lord as he starts revealing things to you that must be done. And I want to thank RJ on the story with his father because I too am a person that for years had, you know, because my father was a military, he was trained to be a professional killer. He would come home, he would fight the enemy, and then he'd come home and want to make us the enemy through domestic violence. That I even had said, told my son that when my father died, I'm going to sit in the back of the church with a bottle of rum and get drunk and celebrate, right? But when I went to prison, God began the healing of that because as I began birthing ministries in the prison, God said to me, oh, this is wonderful. But unless you forgive him, I can't forgive you. Just like that. Mm-hmm. And then the Lord started playing the tape that I heard about my father as a child. He too was a child that wasn't wanted. He too was a child that was the dark skin left behind. He was the overachiever too that just wanted attention, you know? And so even when I became homeless in 2009 because of a situation with my family and stuff, by me working on forgiveness of my father, and I wrote my father a letter of forgiveness while in prison, and I understood when I became homeless because of what happened in my house. I'm living in a domestic violence shelter. I'm running the ministry, trying to do what I got to do. I'm running the court. I get a call from my family telling me that daddy's sick. Apparently, the Lord told me my father had been sick for years, but I used to anoint his door every night. What they told me was he had full-blown fourth-stage cancer and that he didn't want to listen to nobody. And the only one he would listen to was me. I'm like, me? They said, yeah, come home and tell daddy to go to the hospital. So before I got home, the Holy Spirit said to me, take a bottle of oil, pour across that doorway before you cross it. Put the oil on your hand as you're going up the steps, touch the walls. So when I got into the room where my father was and I said to him and I saw him, I said, daddy, I said, are you tired? And you want to go home with grandma and grandpa? He said, yeah. I said, okay. I said, well, do you know who God is? He said, yeah, he the boss. I said, well, okay. I said, let me re-anoint you and you do the salvation prayer. So I know where you will be. He said, okay. And about a month later, my father was gone, but the Lord allowed me to take a picture. And this is what I have to always remember. I don't know if you can see it, but it's a plaque. Mm-hmm. It's a plaque and a picture of my father when I was beside him. After I just got through anointing him, and it says, Lamb Book of Life, Willie R. Sulyans Jr., Accept the Salvation, March 29th, 2009. And that's what's up. That's really what's up. But had I not worked on my forgiveness of my father, there'd been no way that I'd been able to do that. And even with the situation I was in, the storm that I was in right then and there, you know, being homeless and nobody wanted me around and all the hatred and things that were said. But I went in there and did just like the Holy Spirit said. And this is why I tell you, unless you have a relationship with the Holy Spirit and it is allowing them, the Holy Spirit, to keep cleaning you up, keep reminding you. Because I had the same situation with my mother. They used to drive down the road past me, go, doot, doot. And every time they would, I said, the word says, bless those that have cursed you. I said, Lord, just bless them, bless them, bless them. So then when my mother got sick, I went in with the word and took care of her for 2 years. Forgiveness is real when you heal. But this is the trick of the enemy to keep that door open so he can terrorize you. And that's why forgiving people that are going through their change and stuff. I got to the point there when people be acting silly. I know they got an issue. It ain't my issue. Why am I going to respond to their issue? Establish those boundaries. It's very establishing boundaries. And we know when people like that, what you said, yeah, I forgive you, but I ain't going to forget, man. I used to do that one too. You know, but I know today that was just a trick of the enemy to keep a door. Right. You know, as we go closer in Christ and stronger, we learn wisdom and we understand, yeah, those things were horrible things that happened to us that attacked our minds. That's what it was and violated our trust issues. People we thought were supposed to be there to protect us. Even the church hurt. That's another one. Leaders, we go and stand beside them. We think they're going to love on us. And just like the word and Jesus didn't find out, they don't. Because really, the bottom line is people are human. And what people choose to do, that's what they're going to do. Character and integrity are important. God will show you. He will show you. And you don't have to be around people that want to abuse you. God, Jesus came to what? To set the captives free.
Free, show that.
So with that, I'm going to open it up so the rest of people may come. There's so much here, but I just had to share that. Thank you, RJ Elder.
You're welcome.
RJ, God bless you. Thank you for your word. Amen. You know, I didn't hear the first part, like what you said, choosing to forgive, being merciful, being gracious. You know, I'm going to listen to the video again and get all those. But I like what Apostle Gibson was saying, you touched my heart when you were speaking on her parents, because me and my mother didn't have a relationship. It was. She did everything for me, but she didn't make me feel like she really loved me. So, but when my mother got ready to pass, you know, I went to the hospital to see her. And she was like, you know, just laying there. And then we just started talking. We started talking about Christ and we started just talking. And then, you know, as my mother kept going, you know, I actually asked her, was she with Christ and did she know Christ? And so she said, daughter, she said, baby, I don't know her, you know. And then after that, we kept talking. And I didn't know the Lord's Prayer then, but I said, God forgives you for whatever you've done to harm anyone. And then she says, okay. And then she went to sleep. Mm-hmm. And before she went to sleep, it was a big bright light all through the room. And the Holy Spirit was there, you know? And that's a great blessing to get a relationship. It is never the end. It's never the end. It's only the beginning, you know? And it's a great blessing. And I liked it when you said, I scribble, so I got to try to figure it out. Yeah. After, okay, forgive others, and they begin, then forgive myself. That's what I really had to do, you know, learn to forgive others. But, you know, when the Holy Spirit started working on me with forgiveness, it's like when I got raped, he worked on me and he pulled that out. And then it was like, able to accept and say, okay, I forgive that man that did it. Maybe he had something going on in his life that caused him to be this way. You know, so it's a blessing how the Lord works on us to get us to forgive. And, you know, I'm very grateful and thankful for this word, because it changed a lot of things. The forgiveness changed a lot of things in my life to make joy, to bring joy. And I am so grateful and blessed. And thank you, RJ, for this word. It was awesome.
And bless you.
Any other comments? Come on.
Elder Raymond, I tell you, another dissertation. I put on side note, I need these notes. I'm requesting notes. I don't care if Apostle have to email them to me, because you said a lot. I like how you started out. To do anything for him, meaning Jesus, is a blessing. So that already, you know, started off for me. I said, well, I like that. And I tell you, it's a lot. I even try to type notes and so forth, and the definition of forgiveness. And you're right, there's an example, you know, I'll forgive, but I won't forget. And the thing is like, well, it's either gonna be one or the other. It's like, we said we're gonna forgive, but then you already in your heart saying that, you know, I remember she done, but then you say, I know your sermon, your Bible study, really, we got to check ourselves, especially for forgiveness. You know, how can I ask for forgiveness but don't forgive them? Have an open heart to forgive. I love that. You know, and I never heard just like forgiving God. Like, I said, wow, I'm thinking, like, how can I forgive? Like, to me, forgive God, like, really, God, forgive me. It's like, why should I blame God, or why should I forgive God? So I thought that was very different of that. And you're right, thoughts will get you in trouble. You can find yourself at a bad place with God if you don't forgive. That is so true, because some people feel like I can go on and, you know, but you're still in a bad place. Unforgiveness make your heart hard. If you truly forgive, you don't keep record of wrong. I know that's one of the love about Corinthians, like, we don't keep any record. We have to let go of stuff. And you definitely dealt with that, especially with medically, like heart attacks, strokes. Like, I'm down here, you know, unfortunately my mother have dementia, Alzheimer, and even that, I'm part of a club here. I'm two Toastmaster club, but the one down here, someone had gave a speech and she talked about forgiveness, and even she touched on a mental aspect. And I said, I wonder, because I don't know, again, my mom was born in the early 40s. You got to think about Jim Crow, segregation. Civil rights. I was born 20 years after that. So I came into the cusp of still civil rights, Dr. King, the assassination, Dr. King, and so forth. So I grew up like born mid 60s, 70s, and so forth. But I have to understand that era, that something could have happened with, you know, my mom during that time. Again, it's just things I'm hearing, things like things she will say. And I'm saying, like, where's this coming from? But it's like all this was bottled up. And I felt to myself, as a daughter, I said, I wish I could have had my mother go to counseling. But I had to think about it. You know, if I would have done it 20, 30 years ago, she probably would have said, I don't need any counseling. Or she would have wanted to appease me, but then still have that in your heart. And it's like, you have to work it out. If you are sincere to get this stuff out from you, go to a professional counselor or a Christian counselor. But now I'm believe in God. I'm praying. It's so sad to see her in the state. But then one thing you said was so deep about bitterness has a smell. Our action has a smell. And I'm wondering of an odor that I keep smelling, but it's like a little, she takes a shower, I get her ready and so forth. But like, why? I think, okay, maybe she's not washing herself as much, you know, and I do watch her. She does these things. And it's like, wow, God, I never thought of that. And it's so true about what you said. When you forgive, it frees you from captivity. Everything is done in the roots. I like that. And a dress up mess. We cannot be a dress up mess. That's the one that got me. Like, wow, a dress up mess. But I'm telling you, you said a lot. And I'm going to research and find that book about forgiveness, or the name of it, what you said was total forgiveness. And I'm glad that you that way. Even you sharing about your dad and wow, look at God, like what would have been if you still would have been like, okay, see you later, pops, but still have that or whatever. But the fact that they even you call him dad, which you rarely do, you said usually use his first name, but that was a divine indicator by the time you got home. And you know, he had, you know, it was like, look at God. And I think you see what's going on with the world. You see people are hurting and trauma, you know, gun violence happening in our cities. And, you know, we're dealing with, you know, wars. We're dealing with, you know, things going on in the United States and other world countries. And even I remember our former first lady, Michelle Obama, talked about, I will never forgive him, which she's referring to former President Donald Trump. Of course, his words have hurt people and so forth. But for her to say that, it's like, wait a minute, nah, you got to, you know, I know you feel like you don't want to forgive because, you know, even today, he's still spewing stuff. You're like, what's going on? We have affirmative action now tossed out. Everything's being tossed out. We feel like what's going to happen to us as a people, especially as a person of color. But I'm always reminded that no matter what people can do, laws reverse to hurt us as a Christian, hurt us as African Americans. One thing I remember Dr. King says, you know, I'm going to be judged not by the color of my skin, but with the content of my character. My character, which is a godly character, which is a kingdom character. It's going to open the doors for me for jobs, for housing, for whatever. So I cannot worry about, again, I should say, you know, those who listen on this thing, I don't want you to feel like, oh, thank goodness. I mean, we need affirmative action. Okay, it's gone. But that's not the end all of be all. Because if I depend on the law, I'm not depending on the word of God. If God says it, I'm going to do. But the thing is to forgive. I got to forgive these politicians who wants to do us wrong. I mean, it is a whole litany. And the thing is that we have to get it out of our heart. And even things happened to me in Philadelphia that people did me some harm. And I was just like crying, like, how could you lie about me or this and that? But the fact is like, have to be ministered to, like, let it go, let it go. Like the song, Let It Go from Frozen. It's just like, you know, we say this, but some things will take time. Some things are automatic. But thank you, Elder Raymond. Again, it is a dedication. I want them notes. I'm going to find this book because, again, we're in the second half now. We are counting down to the end of 2023, and we need forgiveness, especially church. Church hurts. We are just hurting. And people said, fake it till you make it. Well, I'm sorry, I cannot fake this. I want to get to the bottom of this and live healthy. I cannot have this bottom. God forbid, then I'm forgetting things or memory loss or things like that. And I'm not saying no one had did a research if that's the cause of the dementia or the Alzheimer, but I guess for me, it's like, if you don't take care of it, there's other health issues that's going to occur. And I thank you for bringing up the health issues like the heart attack and the stroke. We figure, oh, I just ate something fatty. I just ate something bad. And that could be the case, but it could be something deeper than eating something that you have no business eating in the first place. But thank you. Thank you, Elder Raymond. Once again, do anything for him. You did it for him. It is truly a blessing.
And you know, they say cancer comes from unforgiveness that releases.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Reverend Anna, I know you got a comment. I know Apostle Crystal got a comment. So, Reverend Anna, make your comment.
Praise God. I won't be on long. I can't stay on long because I have work to do. But Elder Raymond, I'm breaking out into a hallelujah radical praise for you because God has blessed you with healing, forgiveness, love, and peace, even for those few minutes with your dad, which you will carry for a lifetime. Yeah. And he too carried it for his lifetime as long as God saw fit for him to live. So you gave him perfect peace, the kind that surpasses all understanding. Yeah. And I just listening to you, I was thinking about myself. I've sinned. I got 27 years clean now. I've done some stuff in my life. But somehow with my family, I can never live it down. I'm hated. I beg for forgiveness. I get 1 minute of acceptance. Then I get denied acceptance 5 minutes later. One time it's one way, it's hot this way and it's cold the next. It's up this way, it's down the next. I have to put my finger in my mouth and wet it just to see which way the wind is blowing. okay? That's not a way to live amongst your people. All of this has led to emotional abuse and using me, because now I have grandchildren. And so now I have to pay to see my grandkids. It costs me money. If I'm not giving them something or spending something or whatever they can, it's always a monetary thing. I don't even get a Mother's Day phone call, barely a thank you if I send them a present, okay? I don't even get the thank you. But now they kind of switching it up because they realizing, oh, when we don't say thank you, we don't hear from this lady. You know, my birthday, oh, well, those things that we were taught, okay, as children, this generation, these grandchildren don't know it. Amen? So now I've gone to God confessing my sins, and I asked God for forgiveness. And I know I received it because his word says he forgives and he forgets. Because I was looking in the book of Hebrews, it said in 8 and 12, but God is still all-knowing. He said the Bible states that God does not remember our wickedness. So now if God don't remember our wickedness, what am I worrying about other people?
Exactly.
That just doesn't make any sense, does it? Okay. So therefore, in essence, I have to guard my heart. Okay. And I can't cast my pearls among swine. Now, it might sound a little cold-hearted.
Nope.
Okay. But this is what the Lord is leading me. You just can't keep doing this.
That's right.
You're just going to keep getting hurt and hurt and hurt and keep doing the same things, and I'm expecting different results. So I received forgiveness because God, the word says, he forgives and forgets. However, Satan is still holding them hostage to the spirit of manipulation as a tool for me not to forgive myself. But it's too late. I've forgiven me because God told me he forgives me. So I've forgiven my children. Yes, I have. To the point, okay, of having no more, it has no more effect on me. I don't cry no more. I don't hurt no more. I don't mourn no more. I'm not forlorn anymore. Only thing I can do is get down on my knees and say, Lord, draw us closer to you and closer to each other. If that's your will, thy will be done. Amen?
Amen.
So I pray that they will draw closer to God, even if I'm not even included in the picture, okay? And live and love according to his word. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Anna. And remember, that's why I tell everybody, I love people from a distance. I'm a happy camper too, because you won't have that invasion of the body snatchers. Like you said, sometimes, one while it used to be a phone call, I used to hate to see who the caller ID was because I knew trauma was behind it.
Amen. Wait, amen. I'm almost 70 years old. Yeah. I'm in the last quarter. I can't do it like that. My life has to be serving others, serving God, hallelujah. And not say being appreciated, but just being in God's favor. That's all I worry about, not other people's opinions. That used to matter to me. Now, nah, I pass.
What it's about now is loving yourself, a healthy love. If you love yourself, you can love others.
Amen.
When Amen. They got their issues, because listen, not everybody is sold out to this. You know, you got people got one foot. What the word said? You either you hot or you cold. You can't be lukewarm. Gonna spit you out. While they're sitting up there playing these games, you're getting stronger and healthier. You recognize the crackhead moves, as we call them. But you know, these relation to justification, rationalization, like we really care. You
been there, done that.
Right. That's what you did. That's what you still on. I'm happy for you, but I love for you for this one, because sooner or later you will get it right. But that will not be a distraction. See, Amen. That thing comes to distract your mind and pull on your heart. You make you think that you failed. No, you didn't fail. You survived the nonsense, and you recognize that the enemy will use whomever. They don't want to love on you. That's all right. You ain't got to spend no money.
But I feel bad because the kids suffer. You understand? Absolutely. If it wasn't for the fact that the children suffer, they are wearing a burden, okay, of confusion, of not knowing how to love, what to love, when to love, who to love. Okay, they're seeing that being misdirected, where they think that finance, money is the answer, when they don't have a mind or an eye for God.
They can't problem solve. They can't problem solve when the pressures come. That's why, remember the old saying, thank God for those praying mamas, grandmothers. That's what you're here for. Pray.
Yeah.
It's gonna come forth. You know what I mean? And the kids, the times you have spent with them, even though you had to pay money and everything else, they remember the good times you had with them. Because remember, your children were so involved with trying to have you wiped out. They think because you spending money is the way they can get back at you. They don't realize that was a seed that God is using for you to build with your grandkids. Some people don't have a relationship with a grandkid. Amen.
Right. Amen.
I think
God bless you. Thank you.
Sure. Apostle Crystal, you want to make a comment? Then we're going to have Pastor Lee come on. He's going to close us out. Apostle Crystal, you got a comment? Unmute. Okay.
Hi, Crystal. Hi. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Hi, Miss Anna.
Praise God, Sister Apostle Crystal. Okay, amen. Prophetess Crystal, that's what it is. But it's apostle is coming. That's a prophetic word.
She's already apostle, been there for years.
Oh, I haven't seen you in that long. It's been that long, huh? It's
been that long, yeah.
But grace and peace, Apostle Crystal.
Do you have a comment, well, Apostle?
I'm just returning from a prophetic journey.
Okay.
And I thank God that I was able to tune in and hear what the word was. And it touched me in particular. Amen. I am one of those who say, I don't forget. Because, you know, Psalms 34, the word of God says that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth us out of them all. And you know that you've been with me for a number of years, and you've experienced some of the afflictions that I've gone through. Even now, I'm still going through. And there's so much based on what the pastor said. There's so much that we plant, and the roots taking up the nutrients from the soil. And over the years, it's like you've gotten so much that you want to take a stand. But this is the word that God is giving us now, that he hears.
Mm-hmm.
He said that God has receipts, echoing that even your thoughts, before you can even speak, he heard you. He heard it. That we dispute towards each other and the unforgiveness that we live in. So, you know, it's not going anywhere unless we make the effort to do it. The journey that I've been on, and I want to share a little bit of it. I really want to ask for an excuse with the time. I was praying 2 Sundays ago, and God showed me someplace in West Virginia to go to.
Mm-hmm.
And we went up there, and you should see the history of how our people were treated.
Mm-hmm.
In this country. Mm-hmm. Building this entire country, our people did it, and now we don't even have a place of our own. We don't have any roots, any place to of our own. And even the foreigners, they're encouraging the foreigners to come and take what belongs to Black people. I'm not saying that I'm not foreign too, but Black people need to be recognized for the work that they did. And what God had me do, he had me pray for the souls that didn't even know him and were involved in all this bloodshed and crime. And, and I met a woman. She was just sitting on the steps of a hotel, surrounded by papers and leaflets and whatever. And in my mind, I was saying, this is a crackhead. But this Lord had me walk up to the woman, begin a conversation with her, a white woman. And as we started to speak, She was quoting the Bible. And we had just done a word, it was Sunday morning. We had just done a word on Ezekiel, where God has people out there that looks crazy,
mm-hmm.
but they're soldiers for Christ. So we started the conversation, found out that our parents were missionaries in the Congo. And she and her brother have an organization where they're trying to raise awareness that while the Jews, 6 million Jews, allegedly were killed in the Holocaust, and the entire world knows about it, there were over 40 million people killed in the Congo, the Belgium government.
Yeah.
Nobody knows about it.
Yeah.
So I'm talking about two white people in West Virginia, a state that is known for
racism. Yeah.
They are trying to raise awareness of our people that were killed in the Congo, over 40 million, while the Jews bark and shout and talk about their Holocaust. And everybody in the world is supposed to be reverencing them. And at the same time, when Hitler had them in Germany, the Belgians were killing 45 million black people in the Congo. So
still killing them.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that people don't know about this. And everybody knows about the Holocaust, and everybody have to respect that. You understand? So those are the things that God had me praying for on this journey. And I thank God that I was able to hear this forgiveness topic tonight, because that's what he had me praying for.
Mm.
Forgiveness for the people that committed the crimes.
Mm.
Asking forgiveness for those who didn't even know him, but suffered so much at the hands of those people.
Amen.
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 Well, we thank you that you made your journey, and we thank you was able to come on and get this piece on forgiveness, because, yeah, if we don't get forgiveness, people, the racism, the murdering. I know I had a conversation with my new health person here in Montana, and when I talked about human trafficking, she had a nerve to say, oh, it's not that bad here. I said, it's the worst here. It's worse in Montana than New York. And the lady looked at me. She said, why? I said, because of the racism here to Native Americans from here up to Canada. The lady looked at me like she wanted to slap me. But hey, then I told her about the tunnels that down below, and where they're transporting the women out of here, and how the Native Americans already told me some of the vans, how they come and stuff. So here I am, a new jack in your state that you've been here all your life, and you looking at me like I'm crazy. I don't care. Forgiveness.
Yeah, this, but this state, this is what God is saying, Apostle. Excuse me. This is what God is saying. If they don't see you as crazy, you're not doing the work.
Listen, you think I care? And I know the other young girl that was sitting with, so the old lady was the one that was shot. And the young girl said, oh, yes, that's right. It is a lot of white racism. I said, absolutely. You know, but anyway, I thank you for coming on. I'm going to let Pastor Lee make his final comment on forgiveness. Pastor Lee, you've been popping in and out. Come on in here, Pastor Lee. Welcome.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. Give an honor to Apostle Gibson, to each of you. Amen. I bring you greetings from NEFOP, New Inspiration Fellowship for All People. Amen. Praise the Lord. I just had to come in to hear my beloved brother in Christ. Amen. And I just want to be the one to say, you know, Elder RJ, I'm really, really very, very proud to see the growth in you, to see the growth in you,
yeah,
spiritually, to see the growth in your preaching. It is really amazing. And I just want you to know that this is only the beginning. The best is yet to come. Amen. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when you start to go through the process of forgiveness and start to lay things down, yes, the best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. But I do want to encourage our hearts about the saying about I forgive you, but I won't forget. Sometimes it's good not to forget.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what you mean, bro? I'm glad you asked. The reason why it's important that we do not forget, because sometimes we have to learn the lesson.
Yeah.
My God, whatever it was, perhaps it was because you did not have the proper boundaries up. Mm-hmm. And because you did not have the proper boundaries, it allowed whatever to happen to happen. So you have to learn these lessons. If we don't ever learn these lessons, we won't ever. What will happen is that we will find ourselves in cycles with people. It'll be a different face, but the same script. Y'all ever heard that saying that says different cast but same script? Yes, you'll end up repeating the same cycle over and over and over again. And simply, it isn't because you haven't forgiven. It could be simply because you didn't remember, oh, I need to place some boundaries. Right. I need to put some boundaries in place. Yes. I need to have this guideline to show, because some people, they just don't know how to treat a person.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have to show people how you want to be treated. Yeah. Oh my God.
Amen.
That's a horse of a different color. But it's all in forgiveness. You cannot afford to miss the lessons. The lessons you've learned from father, the lesson you learned from church hurt, the lessons that you have learned, you know, you cannot afford, because what will happen if we forget? We won't have no testimony. So how will we be able to assist anybody if we just forget? You know, sometimes it is good to testify of the things that God has done and how he's brought you through. But Elder Raymond, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for the word. Yes, I sacrificed, because over here it is a different time zone. Amen. And anybody know me? I'm usually in the bed at 9 o'clock. Amen. Praise the Lord. But I made the sacrifice for my brother to show that I love you dearly and keep moving forward. Keep moving forward. Love you.
Love you.
Well, I thank you, Pastor Lee. You're such a funny guy. And I love you dearly. It's good to see you here. I love what you're doing with your ministry that God has given you. I want to also thank everybody for joining us tonight. Been working from the fire up here in Billings, Montana, and a topic on forgiveness. Like I said, that's a never-ending subject, forgiveness. Because it is a daily challenging situation. The difference is now we have great discernment from all the wars we have been through.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that we don't get caught up in them Scooby-Doo mix no more, you know.
That part.
Smiling, but don't think I'm sleeping.
That part.
And I will smile, so you know it's okay, but this ain't no trick over here. Okay? We thank God that we have gone through. And like you said, one of the most important things we kept saying the whole thing is you got to establish boundaries. Because it's not that people don't care. They have no clue, because they think they got that entitlement spirit that the world revolves around them. No, baby, we got to share this world together. And if you can't love on me and be kind to me, I can love you at a distance and don't miss nothing. Trust me. I don't have to share my food, my money, no nothing. I still have a good time just with myself.
Amen. So
I want to thank everybody for coming on here tonight. The next one will be in 2 weeks, and we're having a special guest, and that'll be Pastor Bradley Nelson. Let me tell you how the Holy Ghost was working this. It's supposed to have been Evangelist Marlette bringing it, but the Lord had kept dropping on my spirit about Pastor Bradley. First of all, he has a music ministry, powerful music ministry up here. And I'm glad it's been 6 months. We've been fighting to bring it forth, but it'll be coming in 2 weeks. And then right after that, the Lord said, bring him here to the Bible study, because he has a word in his belly that's been burning. And you need to bring it here, because on your platform, because your platform has more people and it goes out more further. This word that he got. So here I go this morning. I had texted him yesterday to find out about it. And just before I'm ready to text him, I get up and everything. I'm sitting there. Here go the enemy. Well, you might as well forget it. He ain't going to come on. I said, well, check this out. I'll leave the slot open. It don't even matter. I'm not looking for nobody. If he don't come on, he don't come on. By the time I got there and got my coffee going, who texts me? Oh, no, I'll be there. You see how the enemy wanted to bring in some trauma, right?
Negative,
there?
Yeah.
But when you know the Lord and you know he tell you to do something, it don't have to make no sense to nobody. Just you obey. The word said, what? My sheep know my voice and they obey. Because God has never operated like the world. He's not in the box. And those that have learned to hear him, because that's all this is about, hearing God's voice. Because in a little while, we ain't going to have no internet. There ain't going to be no telephone. There won't be any communication. And you will be caught out in West, wherever. But if you hear his voice, he'll tell you, go to higher ground this way. But if you don't know his voice, you'll stay in the midst of confusion, not knowing what to do, and wind up having a heart attack, a nervous breakdown, or whatever. So be prepared, because this stuff is getting ready to get critical. That's why we're doing the fine tuning. All this we have gone through is the fine tune to know his voice without a doubt. Don't sit up there like some people talking about, oh, I don't know. How you sure you know? Any fool that says that to you, God already did. Pick a boo. That's another one uncovered. Come on now, somebody. We also have gone through stuff in this training. I know each and every one of y'all characters, even though I'm not with y'all, I know I can say something to y'all and y'all don't look at me like I'm crazy. You be like, I can say something to some other people and they be like, what? I don't care. The information came, because when you get beat up, knocked out, dragged, that's on you because you rejected it, because it's not the way you think it should be packaged. What's that saying? I take my blessings anywhere it come. It can come in a greasy bag. Dog, all right.
I'm telling you.
Send it. Amen. So I want everybody to be encouraged. This forgiveness thing. Now watch after tonight. Watch some people try to pluck your nerves and try to take you down somewhere, and you just got to just bust out laughing and say, it's okay. Just laugh at him. Keep the enemy confused, because listen, these life lessons that we have been given, it has just fine-tuned us. We don't do Alice in Wonderland down the rabbit hole. We sit back and say, okay, whatever. You know, we don't get what they said, we don't get geeked up with nonsense. We're calm people. Our spirits are calm and at peace. Before, it used to be all over the place. Now it doesn't matter what comes out their mouth. I already know the Holy Ghost gonna already tell me, that's an Elmer Fudd move. Leave that alone. Don't pay no attention. Or you say, you know what? Hey, praise the Lord. You have a good day. And dismiss them. You don't have to receive things into your spirit, because you know who you are. You know who you are. You know what you're going through. You know you hear from God. Watch those people that tell you, well, God don't talk to you. That's not what the word says.
Okay. Amen.
So Dr. Smith, pray us out and we're going to shut it down.
Heavenly Father, in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, Lord, we love you. We adore you. We bow down before you. We worship you, Lord. We exalt you, Lord, for you are a mighty God. Hallelujah. Look what have you done tonight, hallelujah. Yes. You brought your people together, hallelujah, to learn about forgiveness.
Yes.
Something that you require of us, Father.
Yes.
Something that you require to the point that you can't forgive us unless we are able to forgive others. That means a lot, Lord. That's shame. Lord. If you're not down with it, then I can't be down with it, all right? And so, therefore, Lord, in order for us to be with you, living according to your word, what you have commanded of us, not asked us, commanded, oh God.
Yes, Lord.
Now, we thank you, oh Lord, that we're able to come together on one accord, in agreement to these things, in agreement to your word, in agreement to your lifestyle, in agreement to your praise and your prayers, oh God. And Father God, I just ask you, as we separate and we go our separate ways today, Father God, that you will bless each and every one on this line, Father God.
Yes.
That you will keep your promise of granting them life more abundantly, Father God. That you will supply all their needs, oh God. That you will give them favor before kings and queens, oh God.
In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Wholeness, not just healing, wholeness in the name of Jesus. For your righteous sake, in Jesus' mighty name, we thank you and we pray according to your word. Amen Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I thank you for that. And let me just close out with Matthew 6, 14 through 15, like it says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, their reckless and willful sins, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive nurturing your hurt and anger with the result that interferes with your relationship with God, then your Father will not forgive your trespass.
My God.
Listen, when I was in the world, I lost a lot. Now that I'm in Christ, I ain't giving up nothing. That was the same way when I came here and took my Abraham journey. I didn't bring nobody. Even though Pastor Anna said she wanted to come, I said, nope, I ain't taking no lot, no wife, nothing. I'm greedy. I want it all. I need it all. I've been suffering for it all. Amen. All that I want to say, amen. God bless everybody. I love you. And I'll see y'all in 2 weeks in the boot camp, people. I'll see you next week for the topic time. Hallelujah.
God bless. God bless you. God bless. Nice meeting y'all. All right, bye-bye.
That was rejected by men. You healed the sick and the blind. You even raised the lame too. 5,000 souls you fed. And on occasion you raised the dead. Even controlled the movement of fish. And you calmed the raging sea. That's not half of the miracles that you performed, you see. It really doesn't matter what others think of you. Oh, but what really matters is who you are to me.